Hello, you're about to ingest Richard Chang's Leicester Square Theatre podcast. My guest this week is Al Murray. That's worth hanging around for. This was a great one. This is sponsored by the Spring and Haven't. The Spring Arts and Heritage Centre is made up of the old Haven't Arts Centre and the local museum. They merged, relocated to the old town hall and were renamed in 2009. I am playing there on the 24th of October with my show Happy Now, which, as I say, hasn't been written, but by the 24th of October definitely will be written. I'm sure of it. The theatre holds about 135 for a seated gig. I don't know if I'll get that many. It's small. The museum is small, but has some brilliant stuff, like an authentic 1950s kitchen, and we've actually transported it into the room. I don't know if you can hear the people working in the kitchen there. We rely on a small, dedicated staff, get lots of volunteers. I would like to name check Sophie, who is the director, and Margaret, who's the brilliant chief volunteer. Well done for all your work. The museum is focused on local history. Haven't used to be a centre for parchment making, and parchment made in Haven't ended up in the Magna Carta and the Treaty of Versailles. Chinny wreck on Jimmy Hill ended up in Jimmy Hill's chin. Scare Electric was first made in Haven't. Oh, come on, it wasn't. It was invented by Fred Francis and produced by the Mini Models Factory in Haven't from 1956. That's definitely true, they say, whereas the Magna Carta one might not be. Recent shows at the theatre include David Starkey, Jenny Eclair, Gareth Gates, good to see him still going, Payne's Plough Theatre Company, and upcoming gigs after September the 16th. Lee Nelson, who's just, well, and as I say, this has just been doing the FIFA thing, that's good. Mark Thomas, he's great. Kiki D, she's lovely. Chris Ramsey, Jonathan Dimbleby, China Crisis, and Shawaddy Waddy, and Richard Herrig. You never thought you'd hear all those names in one list. Let's enjoy Richard Herrig's Leicester Square Theatre podcast. What has happened to my career playing a museum in Haven? Theatre, please welcome a man who doesn't know what letter Luton Town begins and ends with. It's Richard Herrig! Thank you very much. Hello. Welcome to Richard Herrig's Leicester Square Theatre podcast, or as some of the cool kids have begun calling it recently in Shoreditch. Leicester Perth, that's what it's called. Oh, it's spread to central London. I'm going to remember to do this straight away because I keep forgetting to do these extra bits. Matt Locke paid some money for me to say something in the opening monologue. What he wants me to say is, don't worry, I just wanted to give him money as I love listening to Leicester Perth. Thanks. So that was a waste of money from Matt Locke there. But he could have made me say anything he wanted, and he didn't even want me to say that, and I said it anyway. We're going to meet some people in the audience. We're going to meet this young lady here who has an I Paid a Pound badge. They can get those from www.gofasterstrike.com. What's your name?
Matilda.
That's a very popular name now. It wasn't when you were called it, though, was it? You were the only one, weren't you? That's nice. It's good. She's magic, Matilda, isn't she? And she can make levitate things and read books. Do you like reading books?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're good, aren't they? You can have this one. It's called Talking Cock by Richard Herrig. You can have that for free for being the least nerdy man person who's ever sat in that position. What do you do for a living, Matilda? You're an architect? Fucking hell, what's going on? What's happened? Look, that is the bloke. That's like a composite photograph. It's like someone has created a 3D image of a typical Richard Herrig. Look at him, look at him. Not enough beard there. He's still got a beard, a Marvel thing. Got an architect sitting here. Are you with Matilda, sir?
This is my girlfriend's sister.
It's your girlfriend's sister? What? Was your girlfriend meant to be sitting there? No? Why have you come out? Does your girlfriend know that you're here with her sister?
She does, yeah.
What's your sister called?
Freya.
Freya? Fuck, your parents are dicks. What's your name?
Dean.
How did you get it with someone called Matilda Dean? You come up from the council estates, Dean. Bit of rough, that's what happened, isn't it? What's the story behind you being here with your girlfriend's sister? Your girlfriend doesn't want to come. Why on earth would someone called Freya not want to come and sit in the front row of my audience? I can't understand it. She's been to see other shows and decided she doesn't want to come back. Yeah, okay.
fair enough. So you brought. Are you hoping something will? I mean, it's the dream, isn't it? It's every man's dream. Come on. It's not your dream. It is his dream. That is quite insulting to Matilda that it is not your dream. How could you be so rude to Matilda? Not she could say it is my dream, but I'm not going to act on it because I'm too much of a gentleman. That is the right thing to say. Yeah, that is disgusting. He wants to have sex with his girlfriend. You ever found it doesn't work the other way, does it? It's not as exciting to sleep with your girlfriend's, your sister's boyfriend. No, not for Matilda. Bad luck, mate. What do you do for a living, Dean?
I'm a psychiatrist.
How do you think I'm doing?
Muddling on through.
Do you think I'm mentally ill? Or do I have to pay you for you to tell me? Is that how it works?
Maybe just somewhere more private for us to discuss.
Okay. That's how he does it, Matilda. That's how. Let's go somewhere more private. I've got this. You just have to look at this watch, Matilda. Just watch that. That's how it works, isn't it? That's how you do it. I've seen you guys. Anyway, let's crack on. My guest this week is best known, I think, probably. He's not a lot of things he could be best known for. But he's best known as the man who was visited by the urban men on the 1990s TV show Fist of Fun. That's what we're all here to see him talk about. Will you please welcome Al Murray, ladies and gentlemen? Al Murray. Al Murray, welcome. Sit down. Come on in. Wearing a very pink shirt.
It's summer, isn't it?
It is the summer. It's not, it's September, Al. What are you doing? Dressed like that in September, are you insane?
Sorry.
Just remember, nothing topical. Don't talk about FIFA and that guy right. Throwing all that money at that bloke. No one will understand what you're talking about. He's dead now, that guy. Been rubbed out for some reason. Do you remember much about the Fist of Fun Urban Man?
Actually, yeah, I do. I do remember it because I remember at the time you had that show up and running and me thinking, well, known each other a fair while, I might get a few parts in this. I got one part in it and I was really pissed off. I'm like, thanks a lot.
Good part, though.
It was a great part. It was a really funny sketch, that. And made funnier by the conditions under which it was filmed, which was you basically torturing friends of yours by making them run around in the cold in their underpants.
We were there as well. It was very cool.
Were you urban men as well?
It was very, because we did that one in someone's back garden.
That's right.
At least we could come inside and get a bit warm.
Yeah.
Freezing cold. We were running around on. There was a bit where we were running around in. Like an abandoned building knocked down, and then someone was eating. One of the urban men was eating. Someone had been run over, something like that. And it was so cold. We were wearing. Yeah. There were urban men who just wore pants. They're like urban foxes.
Urban foxes. It's really. It's high
they
concept.
Were men.
Isn't it? It's a high concept thing.
It's a good sketch, and you ad-libbed something about this because there's four of us in the back garden. You said we call them George, Paul, John, and Wayne.
Yeah, I know. I came up with a funny line for
you. You made that up.
Yeah.
And because Ringo was Ben Moore.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Worked very well.
Gosh. When was that? Was it 91?
No, it was about 95.
All right, okay.
We were very young and happy. Do you remember? Remember those days?
Just
and
about.
You're also best known as the drummer from Evangelista, the band.
Who
were the house band for Club Z.
Yeah, but we're never in any of the books about Club Z history.
I'd forgotten you were in Club Z.
I know, I was in it. I was in it for a couple of years. Yeah. And,
who was the favourite bass player? This is one of my actual questions. Evangelista was a pop band you were in. Who was the favourite bass player? You notoriously had a lot of bass players.
Paul Ewart.
Okay, he was the best one.
Yeah.
Anyone interested in that question? I think I have found the question for Al Murray that nobody would possibly be interested in.
This is wonderful.
That's what I'm going
for.
We
had two really good tunes.
Yeah. Mm. Hum them now for me.
I can't remember.
Can you do the drum part?
I can do the drum part.
Because you played drums with Phil Collins.
Yeah, I've played drums with Phil Collins.
McFly,
yeah.
You played drums. You McFly. Played the drum. I turned
I've played,
on the TV.
Played in the band that do stuff for Queen as well. They aren't quite Queen. I've played with them as well. Which was really frightening, properly frightening.
Right.
Yeah. Because Brian May's in front, and you know, you don't want to mess it up.
What would he do, Brian? Because he's...
Well, he'll set those hounds over the foxes to hunt on you, won't he?
Very angry about the...
He's the defender of woodland creatures. It's rather sweet.
Anything, does it have to live in a kind of burrow for him to be interested, basically?
Or... I think probably, yeah.
He would be upset about the urban men, that's the thing. If he knew those urban men were out there being chased, they were chased by huntsmen. Do you think by the time we're doing this that fox hunting will be legal again?
I don't know.
Yeah. thought you knew about politics now, that's why I got you on.
Well, I don't know, because it's clearly a trap, isn't it? It's a piece of political manoeuvring. It's a trap by the Conservatives to flush out the SNP and bring in this thing called evil, which is really funny.
Yes.
English votes for English laws. It's really funny that it's called evil.
English votes for English
laws. Evil. It's really good.
Yes.
It's but dastardly like politics, isn't it?
I propose my evil
plan. My evil scheme begins. Like, you know, Prime Minister, we need to change the name of it. But it's, I don't know. I don't know what's going on, Rich.
No. But you did know.
No idea.
So you've been doing... You did a character called The Pub Landlord.
Yeah.
That some people might have seen. But you've been doing quite a lot of stuff, like as Al Murray.
Yes.
Like a lot of documentaries and books.
Yeah, bits and pieces and books and some radio and stuff, yeah.
Is that a conscious decision to move away or to move in tandem?
No, it's the conscious decision to earn money doing something else.
Right.
because I tend to tour... I tend to do like a two-year chunk of touring, so... I have 6 months off and I'm meant to be writing, put it together, tour for 9 months, then extend for 9 months with other bits and pieces. So to stay fresh and do other things, I do things as me. Mm-hmm. But it's not to move away or, you know, I mean, I really love the kind of language that goes with all this. You know, have you quit? Have you retired? I thought you'd finished doing it. And you think, no, we just haven't, just not on tour at the moment, you know.
I mean, I think The Pub Landlord, it seems to... stay relevant. It seems to have survived. I think if it was not going to survive, it would not have survived
well,
by
I get,
now.
What know? I really love is what's been interesting about the last 6 months is people saying to me, "Your act's out of date and irrelevant." You think, are you paying any attention to what's happening in politics right now? Any at all?
Yeah.
And that's why I mean all of what happened this year came from one line in the show that I did last year, which is you know, country's ready for some bloke waving a pint around offering common sense solutions. That I wrote a show based around last year, long before we ever thought of the Thanet thing, and that was the line. Because I think there's been this way of looking at the world, this bubbling under, this reductionist thing, the way the Pub Landlord thinks, hasn't gone anywhere.
No,
and wasn't new when I came up with it either. If I'm honest.
No. Do you think that UKIP were? Do you think there was an element where it was slightly reverse engineered from the pub? You know, the Pub Landlord. Because it works so perfectly for you to come back. And we will talk about this at length. We might as well just talk about it now.
No, save it up.
Okay, we'll save it up.
Save the gold.
We'll work up to it. But do you think, you know, that is sort... It is interesting. I mean, that character obviously is appealing to people as well as they're laughing at it. It's often difficult to know.
But that doesn't matter.
No.
That's like an argument against... I always think that argument is an argument against art, against creativity. If someone can't look at a portrait and get different things from it, then it's you're arguing against imagination, creativity, and art itself. If a piece of art has to have a label on it which says, you've got to take from this one thing, or you're stupid, or you're incapable of subtle thought, then it's not art, it's a failed thing. And I'm bewildered that argument gets put forward quite often by intelligent people who just haven't considered what they're saying at all.
I think it's quite interesting that I think it's also once you get in front of a lot of people, then there's going to be a lot more diversity of opinion.
Because lots of people are different.
Yeah.
I mean, wow.
I think it's sort of interesting because I think Stuart Lee was always one of the people who would make this accusation about the audience not understanding it or not getting it.
How does he know?
He doesn't know. But also now, if you look at his audience, I think if you look at his audience online, there's a lot of them who don't necessarily understand.
Well, someone today on Twitter said to me, go watch Stuart Lee on Context to figure this out for yourself. And I said, well, I lived with him for 2 years, so I don't really need another lecture about fucking Context off it. Right?
But I think it's kind of because you can't control, you know, now he's at the point where you've got the audience
that
big, you can't control the way your audience react to your stuff.
And that's the point of art, is you can't control what people make of it. You put it out there, you hope that some of them understand it, I mean, jokes as well. There was this thing with jokes. I don't get it. You can get things and not like them as well. You can, you know, there's more than just whether you get a joke or not. There's, you can get a joke, not like it. You can find some jokes funnier than others. I mean, yeah. it's these things are never as simple or as binary as people want them to be. Want to box them in and categorise them. And, you know, these are arguments that against creation and against creativity and art and, you know, which isn't to say... I mean, you start talking like this. I'm not saying it's art. What I do is I'm an artist, but that is, it's essentially a destructive argument. That.
Yeah, and you know, I think there is an element of how do you know how they're laughing?
How can anyone know?
You're judging.
I don't know what they're laughing at. I don't know what they're laughing at. I know they're laughing at the thing I've come up with, but I don't know why. Because, and I don't want to know why. I don't want to peer into your head and find out what you think. That's mental. That's a mentalist's strange way to behave, isn't it? And very often, I mean, I also think what goes with this as well, and this is a kind of a current thing at the moment, is things are expected to be labelled at the moment. You're supposed to announce your intentions, I think. There's certainly a lot of stand-up, and people are doing that, announcing their intentions. Why? I assume my audience is going to keep up with what's going on. If they don't, then, you know, that's all right. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You know, I've every now and again I have a review, and I know what the reviewer wants me to do is at some point go, by the way, vote Labour. Right? And I'm not going to do that, because the pub landlord wouldn't do that.
No.
You know. No.
But it's true, you are restricted. But I mean, when it takes the nuance out of comedy and when it takes any, you know, things... Comedy, in a sense, has to be... misinterpreted a little bit, you know. That's there has to be some confusion within what you're saying. That's what a joke is. That we're not sure. Or there's a double meaning, or there's two ways of taking stuff. So when you're doing something like the pub landlord, which I think has always clearly been an idiot who might occasionally say something that some people might agree with, but then
stock clocks are wrong twice a day.
They are, and that's why. Ted Heath had sex with boys and killed people. That's what that stock clock keeps on saying. Keeps on saying it. And I'm listening to the stop clock. The reference to the last podcast.
Yes, but that was in September, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was last week. Only a week's passed. It feels like longer.
The words were hanging heavy in the dressing room backstage.
But no, I find it interesting because it is, you know, the more, you know, and I'm sort of, I don't know, the more that people worry about comedy and worry about what the way things are being taken. I mean, I think you have to up to an extent. You are still, as a comedian, you have to take the repercussions if you do something that is actually evil. But not many comedians do that, really.
No, not many,
so,
really.
But if you're so worried about offending people, or that if you are sort of going, I'm not trying to offend people here, you can tie yourself in knots, which some comedians get out of, but it also does or get something out of.
I just, these things also run into my experience of doing radio on the BBC, which of course is the greatest institution the world's ever known, and I'm not saying that because they pay me to work for them. When you go on that, there's always this tango with the people in compliance, and you want to say to them, "Don't worry, I'm not an idiot. I'm not going to go on radio at 11 o'clock on Saturday morning and call the Pope a cunt. It's all right."
That might be what they're worried about, that you start with that.
It may be. No, but it's amazing how you know, kind of worried they get. And we've had some... with 7 Days Saturday, if any of you listen to it, thank you very much. And we really enjoy making it, but although the cricket's on now, so basically it consists of Andy Zoltzman watching the TV and the guests sat opposite him going, what? Why are you not listening to me? But we were on air the week of the murders in Tunisia.
Right.
And so you immediately get, you know, understandably, you get the kind of compliance thing of, please be careful. The idea that you wouldn't be.
Yeah.
You know, and I always think you should assume that your audience are bright and are going to keep up, and maybe compliance people should assume that the comedians are bright and going to keep up and going to make discreet decisions and discreet judgments, you know.
Yeah.
But in the end, you can't control exactly where we were a moment ago. You can't control what people make of the thing.
But almost the compliance thing.
You're mad to try. Stalinist to try and say, you know, this is what you should think of this.
But the compliance thing almost is part of the BBC trying to destroy itself. It seems to me that it was, you know, it's that the BBC is being so anxious to be seen to do the right thing and be seen to be fair when it clearly is fair. I mean, if it had political influence over the last election, how come the Tories and won and the UKIP got 3 million votes or whatever they got?
Yeah.
So they are a left-wing bias, but it's the most fair thing. But like the compliance thing, it's part of the reason I'm doing this, because these podcasts came out of doing radio shows and them saying, don't even swear in the warm-up in case there's someone from the Daily Mail in the audience. You're going to go, what? This is so restrictive. If I say something wrong, it's your job to edit it out, but don't...
Yeah.
But, you know, I probably won't, but if I do, take it out. That's what... You're the safety net. So it's kind of weird when it's becoming so restrictive and the BBC
Well, it's the permanent bugbear of charter renewal and all that, and then, they make these moves to try and assuage it. And it's that thing of... They've given the inch, and the mile will get taken. Although, of course, it was some comedians who created the situation in the first place.
Yeah.
So, well done, fellas.
Russell Brand's responsible for a lot of things. The election was his fault as well, wasn't it? That was telling people not to vote. Do you think anyone listened to Russell Brand about that and about not voting?
Yeah, enough.
You think so?
Yeah.
I think what's interesting with this...
Of course it did. You know, some people will have done. But you know, I get the sense with his stuff is he's kind of preaching to a choir anyway. So.
Yeah. But what's interesting is the minute that election's over, because no young people voted, the government doesn't have to care about what young people think.
Right. So young people, we maybe need to figure out how that equation works.
Yeah.
pensioners haven't they?
Yeah.
You get socialism if you're a pensioner. Yeah. Everyone else had better turn out and vote if they want it for themselves. You know, blah, blah, blah.
So let's talk about it then.
Yeah,
it was an interesting decision. I really liked the decision to stand. It felt like a great piece of... Well, it is a bit like the Lee Nelson thing at FIFA that happened back in July.
Yeah.
Where it's an
act... Did you do the thing in Glastonbury the previous month to
that?
Yeah,
it did, yeah.
Yeah.
So
it was about 4 weeks before that.
It was. Yeah, that's fine. Okay, that still works. But you know, to actually interact with the world in a satirical way, I think like it was so for the right time to do it. I think with Farage, it felt to me like it might make. I mean, I don't know if it did make any difference. What do you think? Do you think it was part of the reason he lost?
318 people rallied to my cause. But a vote for me is a vote denied for anyone else.
Yeah.
So, God knows.
But it made him, you know, what the satirical element was for you to stand next to him at any point, but certainly when the announcement came out, but at any point, is to make him look ridiculous and to point out that he is the same.
Well, but also the whole thing, too.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, actually, one of the things we made sure we did not do was say I was running against Farage, that I was running against UKIP. We were running against everyone, against all runners and riders. Interestingly, all the people who told me I was making a mockery of democracy seemed to be UKIP supporters, right? And I was kind of just hoping for one Labour supporter to come and say, you're making... But it didn't happen, I don't know why. But we'd modelled all of the output, all of the satire and the book on what everyone was talking about, because we've entered this really sort of strange kind of... odd kind of politics where Labour would go, you know, 8,000 nurses if we get in. You think, well, all right, then 8,001. And, you know, 20,000 new doctors. Brilliant. Yeah, 20,001. You know, has it come to that?
Yeah.
You know, and so we got quite stuck into that. And actually, when the Edstone came out, you know, which was just... There you go. That's where we've got to, right? The Edstone. You know, there's some bright people thought that was a brilliant idea. Is glorious, right? We did a fag packet, or we'd done a fag packet with our 5 pledges on, including free dogs, and because people like dogs. Because that's what this election degenerated into: a series of essentially unmanageable, undeliverable promises. And our fag packet looked so much like the Edstone. It was kind of like, well, are they following our Twitter feed? I don't think they are. You know, it was amazing. But I did it... last year, I'd written a show about politics. I'd done it already, because I knew the election would be coming up. And also found Twitter and politics a particularly interesting thing to watch. Right? Because Twitter called the election so uncannily well. Twitter has also brilliantly predicted how Greece was going to face down Europe. you know, the mood on Twitter and the way politics gets expressed on Twitter, I find really interesting. So I'd written a show all about politics, and obviously there was an election to come, and I knew, and I'd figured that Russell Brown was going to write his books. It was going to be a thing that was in the air. And then I was at a gig in Cambridge, and you know my old friend Gavin,
yeah,
right, I've known since I was like 10, and he's basically the only person who, if he says, "I don't like that routine," I listen to him. Right. Other people are going, "No, I don't, fuck off," or I'll think about it and figure out the five rebuttals. But with him, I go, "Yeah, okay, probably." I don't know why. And he said, "You're going to run for Parliament, aren't you? We're in a pub after the gigs. You're going to run for Parliament, aren't you?" I said, "What?" He said, "Well, come on. You've got to run for Parliament." Because I was at the end of the last half hour of the show, it was literally, "Let's create a manifesto of common sense promises to save the UK from itself, blah, blah, blah," you know. And the people put up and asked, "What are you going to do about this?" So I was doing it, and he said, "You're going to have to run for Parliament." And then, you know, light bulb, doink. Where's Nigel Farage running? And so we went from there. And then what happened is that week, Russell Brand, having told people not to vote, which I basically, no two ways about it, I think was a disgusting thing to do, but and wildly responsible, but there you go. That's because I'm a boring old fart who believes in the establishment. Fucking crap. And he went on Question Time that week, and that bloke went, "Well, why don't you run then? Why don't you run, Russell?" And he went, "Oh, I can't, man, because I'll just turn into one of them paradigm dialectical..." "Not Red Piketty, but I'll say it, you know." But Karl Marx, wow, he said this. Yeah, because Karl Marx was addressing mid-19th century problems with developing industrialisation in this country. Anyway, not the point, right? Not the point. That happened on Question Time, and my manager then rang me immediately and said, "We have to run now. We have to run. We've got to do it." So then it turns out it only costs 500 quid. You fill in the forms, and you're off. And you need an office either in the constituency or an address either in the constituency or in the neighbouring constituency, so you can have an agent's office. And after I'd announced it, just after New Year, my old drama teacher from school had rang up, and I'd not spoken to him in a very, very long time. He rang me up and he goes, "Oh, I live in South Thanet now. Retired to there. Do you want to use my address?" I'm like, "Yeah, okay, yeah." And then we needed 10 signatories, because you need the address and you need 10 signatures, and then put your 500 quid down. I said to him, "Would you be a signatory, please?" You know, might as well. I don't think I will. "Okay. I can't count on your vote then, Mike." But even then, of course, I mean, the interesting thing was it really was like putting my head above the parapet. It was really interesting.
Yeah.
And really, we did a day where I turned up to submit my initial papers or whatever at the start of the long campaign, and we'd done that ad in the Metro as well. So it was all sort of happening and announced. And then we did the second thing where I was supposed to do the parachute jump and I was too heavy. And so funny on the day. And we are, everyone involved, we are all rolling around on the floor like laughing at this because it's so fucking funny. Because right? I've skydived a few times. Although the last time I did it properly, I did get to the door of the aeroplane thinking, "Why are you doing this? You could die, you know, it's just a terrible thing to do." But it was a bet and I made a friend do it and all this sort of thing. Anyway. So I said, "Why don't we do the stunt where I parachute into the constituency, literally? You know, let's literally do what they say I will be doing, right?" You know, why not? You know, join, play them at the game, you know, or take part in the game and comment on it at the same time, you know, blah, blah, blah. And so we went to this airfield in Kent, turned up there, and got there very early. And there were 15 cameramen or something, and local papers, Sky, everybody, basically. Danish papers, someone from East Guinea. Or something, or somewhere like that, or West Guyana. I mean, I don't know, right? And we get there, and it's me and my agent Bjorn was there, I think. Was he there? I can't remember. And Dan, who does my press, and Trish, who does all the internet stuff. And we get there, and I weighed myself. You know, I knew I had to be a certain weight to be able to jump, because it's tandem and everything, and you know, you don't want to kill the other person as well. And I pay the money, or I'm about to pay the money, and we've been through the full safety briefing and everything, and I'm going to do it in the costume with the jumpsuit over it. So when I've landed, I just unzip it, James Bond, and get out the costume, and I'm in pub landlord garb, and we're trying to think of a way of, is there a way of bringing in a pint in a, you know, like, the answer's no. And she goes, okay, brilliant, love, just one more thing, can you get on the scales for me? And I get on the scales, and she goes, you're overweight. And that was the end of that. So we then find ourselves actually in a like news management spinning situation where our brilliant plan's gone horribly wrong. We've got to come up with a statement to deliver to the press because the press are there. One of the we say to the parachute people, please don't tell anybody, right? And they tell one of the hacks. So immediately one of them comes over. Is it true you're not jumping? I said, I don't know about that. It's nothing to do with me. And then so eventually I do a statement, and I do this whole thing about how I'm a victim of the obesity epidemic, and you know, quite tightly written, you know, 8 joke thing that of course they all ignored and went, look, these two fat that come. And the papers basically ran with, look at this fat cunt. And I'm going, yeah, I know, right? I've said so. We've made a joke of it, and then of course you get the hornets on Twitter going, "Look at you! I'm at ease with this, you know. It's really not. You're not really getting me with a silver bullet there." So anyway, so then we went into Sandwich, and did a press launch and everything.
That was the last thing you needed at that point.
Well, absolutely. The issue was maybe one too many, because we were going to do sandwiches in Sandwich. With the, you know, because it's shit politics, because yeah, that's what they do, yeah, right? Yeah. So we had a thing in a pub, and there was a guy from the reality party called Nigel, because there were two Nigels in South Thanet. Reality party guy called Nigel, which was Bez's party.
Right.
And they kind of, their manifesto is possibly what you might expect it to be. Right? Right? Although, you know, some very positive food bank stuff and all that sort of thing. Yeah. But quite a lot of the things you might expect them want to be legal.
Yeah.
Right? And... And he turns up and he starts yelling at me, going, "You're not a real pub landlord." And like, you know, I know that as well, right? And then what happened is we had the full thing with the media, and what was actually disappointing about dealing with the broadcast media is they kept going, "You went to Oxford. You're not a real pub landlord. What are you doing? You're making a mockery of everything." No. Play. If we do this together, we'll get something. You'll get something more interesting out of it than simply trying to trip me up.
Yeah.
And I came out the other end of that day quite sympathetic in a way with what politicians have to put up with, because all anyone wants them to do is slip up. They want them to say the gaffe. They want them to catch them out. So they get the scoop. So they derail the politician. The politician's out off balance. He's caught out. Or she's caught out. You know, blah, blah, blah. And that's all they're interested in. And they will also ask you this. There was one guy from BBC Kent who asked me the same question probably a dozen times. I'm actually the same question. And by the end, when I'm like, for Christ's sake, you know the answer. So, you know, and then I've lost my temper. And then it's like, you know, they use that one and you look like you've lost it. And I actually came away, because no one has to be a politician, you know. So I came away from it with a like grain of sympathy for some of what they have to put up with.
Yeah. But it's interesting, all the stuff you're saying about it. I mean, it's so spun and everyone's so trying to, I mean, and this is the point you're making. But and also everyone's trying to appeal to what they think people want.
Yeah.
Don't you think that politicians should not be allowed to poll the public and just have to say what they think and then we decide?
Well,
if
I think.
We want to vote.
Well, I think this. I mean, as a result of this general election, there's a very strong argument for no opinion polling for the last couple of weeks, like they have in France, or like they don't have in France.
Yeah.
I'd say, but I mean.
But you know, it's just like that. If a politician is just trying to say what they think you want, I think it almost, you know, I think part of the success of UKIP is down to someone coming in and seemingly going, "I'm not going to say," you know, even though I think it's more and more spun as it goes on. Mm. But it's a bloke coming in saying, "I'm just going to say what I think, and this is what I think."
Well, that's
and so people sort of respect him for that.
Yeah, yeah, and he's the outsider.
Yeah, yeah.
He's got all that going for him. We did have a problem when we were doing the content. It was, we'd get outflanked by them, though, all the time. You'd try and say something really ridiculous, and you'd think, yeah, that's really funny. No one would ever say that. Oh, fuck me. They're all the way over there on the right. But, you know, it was really... I mean, it was an interesting thing. I was so glad when it was over. The last 2 weeks were really, really... was a lot. It was sort of oddly pressured, and I got quite sort of got fed up with the sort of getting in the way of just being a comic and getting on the tour I was on at the time. Because of course we did it spontaneously, so I had to fit it all around a tour. So at the crucial campaigning period, I was in Norway doing gigs. And what was really funny with the journalists is it took the TV media about a month to go online and look at my touring dates. And they'd come back and they'd go, "You aren't even in Thanet on the night of the election." I said, "Yeah, I know, we announced that date a year ago." Right? It really funny how kind of essentially unwell briefed they were. I'm not going to say lazy.
But if you'd won, would you have written yourself or the pub land or had won, the House of Commons?
And I did think about this. If I had won, and I didn't think about this because I have a towering ego that needs satisfying. I just, you know, because I was in it. You've got to be in it to win it. I could have won it. I would have done every. If this was a MP surgery, I wouldn't be in character. I'd be taking you seriously and listening to you seriously, right? In the House of Commons, I would have gone in character and been shouting things like "objection, objection, overruled," like not clapping. Although again, I've been outflanked there. Yeah. And I'd have done it in the blazer. I'd have done it in the blazer, and probably I would have probably done it for a year, and then dined out on it for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
Because it would have been an amazing thing to have done. It would have been fucking hilarious. Well, that's the other thing. When people say, "Why did you do it?" Because I thought it'd be really funny. That's why I did it. I thought it'd be really, really funny.
Yeah.
And in general, it was. I mean, there were some hairy moments, but in general, it was funny.
Yeah. And it's good publicity for your tour and book.
Well, no, the book came out of doing it.
Yeah.
So the book wasn't... That egg and chicken don't happen in that order.
But, you know, everything... I don't think it's... I'm being...
No.
Because I don't think.
Well, again, that's one
everything's
of the,
publicity for well, you know. We're trying to sell something.
Well, that's it. That's one of the silver bullets. The angry exile 2 would come out on Twitter and go, "You're just trying to get publicity. I'm in show business, baby." Yeah, you're just attention seeking. Fuck me, I am. You know.
And it's not like the other politicians aren't trying.
Well, exactly. And then the people going, "Look at you pushing product." When the book came out, look at you using this to push product. So all I'd ever, if someone tweeted me that, I'd send them the link to Nigel Farage's book.
Yeah.
It was out at the 2 weeks before mine.
I'd quite like to see, and when you did this, I think so a lot of comedians are interested in politics, and I think the political system needs massively changing.
Yeah.
Like, just, you know, start again.
But it only ever does.
I think you could modernise it. You know, I think Russell Brand saying, "Let's have a revolution," it's, you know, you need to use democracy to change things in a positive way, which you could do very easily because not many people are voting, and that's why UKIP, again, is working, because all the people who want to vote for UKIP vote for them.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, people who believe that stuff aren't voting for it.
And
but you could have a comedians' parliament... Yeah. Where 650 comedians stand in 650 constituencies, and then they get in, and then they just change things. I think there's just a few things need to change. The Houses of Parliament should be turned into a hotel and a tourist attraction, and you use the money from that to build a proper parliament that can seat everyone who's
MP
in the centre of the country, maybe, where it's cheaper to build. you've got that prime location, so we can make a lot of money from that, and also the building isn't fit for purpose and it's costing lots of money to upgrade. Probably just bring in proportional representation straight off the bat. Just need a bit.
Well,
if you're
going
to have democracy, you've got to have democracy. Yeah. I don't care. I think UKIP. It's terrible that UKIP got all those votes and got one seat. That's disgusting.
Yeah.
Because that, if you believe in democracy, it's got to be democratic.
But if you scale that proportionality up, I got more votes than the SNP. If I'd stood in every constituency in the country
and got 318.
I'd got, you know. I've made that figure up.
Yeah.
There needs to be a reckoning. There needs to be something changed. But I mean, the interesting thing
and
about
that
it
old,
is,
that
we just don't know what's around the corner.
No.
After all, I mean, and you'll know this better than I, because you paid much more attention at university. It was Disraeli who brought in the Great Reform Act, didn't he? Who went, "Okay, this doesn't work. I'm going to have to change the way the vote works and bring more people in, involve more people again." And he did that by extending the franchise, which didn't look like it. Didn't serve to his advantage initially, because then Gladstone got voted in. And maybe at some point, if our politicians, they know that somehow they've got to reconnect. And they're not going to do it by going on Twitter or doing stones with waffle fucking engraved on the back. Disgraceful mistake, right? They're not going to do it by doing that. They may have to do it by going by giving actually how people vote the shake,
yeah.
Even if it costs them being in government, because they need to claw back some credibility.
Yeah,
I think, and that's the way to do it, isn't it? It's to, sometimes the way to act credible is to do something that's not in your interest.
Yeah, well, absolutely, and I just think none of them are doing that, and then that pushes them further away. And the Labour and Liberals have managed to self-destruct anyway, so they might as well have done.
Yeah, it's amazing.
It's sort of incredible we've ended up in a situation where the Tories have a majority and are likely to have so for the foreseeable future.
Yeah, but they may yet implode over the EU, which is 18 months away, that vote or something. We don't know yet, and they may half of them might go Tonto on that, which might be really interesting.
Need to start again. That's all. I mean, the House of Parliament is so, and it's interesting the SNP going in because they are like, they're a bit more like regular normal people,
yeah.
And so they behave like normal people, yeah. And it's not all the jokes that politicians do are so bad.
Yeah, but if the jokes
and then everyone goes,
if the jokes were good,
like a fucking
if the
child.
Jokes were good, I mean, we'd be out of work.
Man, I'm not sure. I think it'd be nice. It'd be entertaining. Just intelligent people who are entertaining who don't just. You know, the jokes show how stupid the people are because the jokes are bad and intelligent people can tell good jokes.
Yeah, but
and don't need to go to those.
But by the same token, I think I'd be a really shit MP.
I don't know if you would.
I know I would. I haven't got the application. I'd get bored. I'd go, whatever.
Yeah, that's probably
who
true.
Who cares about the underpass for the hedgehogs?
I sort of think it's...
That was the interesting thing. We did do a little bit of canvassing and focus group stuff and... The thing I found most fascinating about that was you have a general election to elect a national government and all anyone wants to talk about is dog shit. And literally, that was the number one issue with everyone, certainly in Ramsgate. They don't put the dog shit up. Right? So I'm voting for Nigel because he'll fix that. You think, what, he's going to come around and pick up all the dog shit?
He offered to do
that. I mean, maybe... And that's really interesting. The local issues that they weren't voting on were making up their minds about the national ones. And that, there's a proper tension and problem in our politics. Because, bins, the street out front of your house, the part with dog shit in it, that's your actual right in front of your environment.
Yeah.
In or out of the EU is a bit more esoteric, possibly.
They should pay politicians like £150,000 a year each and no expenses. But it's an important job. People complaining about the rise, and they should pay them proper money. Mm. It's a really fucking important job.
Well,
and you want people who'll do it and then not do something else.
And the reason they aren't being paid proper money is because of this thing, people going, well, they can't have a pay rise.
Yeah.
And so they ended up fiddling their expenses because they felt they weren't being adequately rewarded for the job.
Or doing other jobs. So no, if you're an MP, you shouldn't be allowed to do another job for the time you're in the Parliament. You say, I'm going to give up my other job.
Well, because if you're a minister as well, you're an MP and a minister, so you've immediately got two jobs.
Well, yeah, but you can't go and write for £2,000 columns for the Times or whatever it is that Boris Johnson does or whatever, and all the other stuff as well. Anyway, that's what I'm going to do when I do the next election.
We're going to man the barricades for that one. No more Boris Johnson columns.
that's what I'm most upset about. And so you've had to deal subsequently to doing this with a lot of people on Twitter. I was going to call them idiots, but...
Well, and Facebook as well. I mean, on Twitter, you get someone go, you are a traitor! And you go, okay, well, why do you feel that? And then they go, you're not standing up for what you believe in your country. And I go... And you'd think, well, by starting off by calling me a traitor, I don't know that we're really going to get along, right? It's not the best opening gambit, is it? Like, and some of it very heated. And then, of course, the thing that always gets wheeled out is, people didn't die in World War II for this. And you're like... And I actually got to the point with a bloke on Facebook where he's going on about it. My grandfather did die in World War II, right? And he's telling me what the war did this, that and all that. And you think, fuck off, right? My mother never knew her father because he died in World War II, so we could have the freedom of expression. And expression includes going, ha-ha, aren't politicians hilarious? Or isn't politics... funny, or saying whatever you want.
Yeah.
Some of it made me very angry, but some of it was really, really funny because my motivations became a big subject of mind reading and discussion.
Yeah.
The my favourite, because it's really mental, is last year there was a newspaper that ran a, or there's a genealogy website that did a press release about who that David Cameron was related to me, right? That we're cousins, right? Because someone in his family married someone in my family, the Thackeray thing. And my great-great-great-grandfather is William Thackeray, right? Who wrote Vanity Fair. Mediocre novelist, according to Richard Stew, back in the day. It's the great, I think it's the greatest satirical novel of the 19th century, but there you go. Anyway.
Maybe the 19th.
Yeah, I'll take the 19th. Yeah. But we can confine it to that, it's fine. And someone in Cameron's family apparently married someone in Thackeray's family, right? But that's 200, I mean, it's 200 years ago, right? They married each other. I'm not in that, you know, bloodline, you know, nationalists' bloodline, right? Not in the bloodline, right? So we aren't cousins by any stretch of the imagination. Or if we are, so are 800,000 other people, right? The year before, they said he was related to Kim Kardashian. And the year before, they said he was related to Barack Obama, right? So, but anyway, so what you had is people going, oh, he, you know, kippers, basically, or frothers. And what I prefer about Facebook, in a way, is you can go look at their page and they tell you everything you need to know, you know, like, the, you know, all the kind of Britain First, all that kind of stuff was in there, right? And because Facebook's political temperature is very different to Twitter's, I think. Twitter seems to lean left. There's 800,000 likes on Britain First on Facebook, right? So it leans maybe in the other direction, right? Anyway, where was I? I've distracted myself. Bollocks.
Well, you kippers.
Yeah. So they go, well, your cousin Dave. You're doing this for your cousin Dave, right? And I said, well, I'm not his cousin. Yes, you are. Look at this article. Then, read the article. Probably not cousins.
Yeah.
Right? And I said, so what? You're actually telling me my long dead relatives have put me up to this? Yeah. And even there was one guy, and what I found really interesting about a lot of these conspiracy ideas is people don't test them before they fire them at you. There's one guy, you know, my grandfather was an ambassador, right, in the 60s in Greece, as it happens, and then he was in the consulate in Egypt and then in Spain, and I think he sort of specialised in trying to deal with fascist governments, post-war fascist governments. I don't know though, because he died when I was 13, 14. We never got to talk about it. But according to someone on Twitter, he nevertheless, before he died, managed to put in the necessary calls at the Foreign Office to ensure that I would do well as a comedian.
That's all it takes.
Yep. And then of course, the other one is I'm a Tory stooge. The Tories have put me up to it because of my cousin, and they've paid me to do it, right? They paid me to run in Thanet. Now, if you're the Conservative Party, you want to win the seat in South Thanet, surely what you do is spend the money on the candidate, on the Conservative candidate who's running in the constituency. That would make more sense than paying me. Right? And so you'd say to them, all right, okay, who made the calls? How much? Where's the money? And they go, oh, I don't have to prove anything. Well, actually, you do. You have just libeled me, you know. And on it went. And there was one guy on Facebook, and I want to read you some of this because it's really, really, I've come slightly prepared because this is really funny. There's one lad, God bless him, who did this whole thing of calling me a traitor and all this sort of stuff. And, right. You have to read these in the right order. Okay. He, at one point, here you go. Whoever is writing this, this is me on Facebook. I reply on Facebook myself, right, on the fan page. Might as well. Whoever is writing this isn't Al Murray, but a very young person, probably a girl, either working for Alistair. That's the other thing, is they go on Wikipedia and find my full name, which is Alistair, right? Yeah. And they go, there, see? Right? Yeah. He's up to something. And the sheer number of people called Steve who would come to me and say that, or Joe, you go, Joe, you know, what's your game? You know. Anyway, and no one calls me Alistair. My dad does, and it annoys me. No one calls me that, right? So it's really weird, you know, it's not my name, you know.
Algernon,
Rich, you know, Richard Herring, is it? You know, probably a girl, either working for Alistair or just helping out as a favour. I couldn't possibly know. Well, no. No, you couldn't, right? You couldn't, right? And then I go, probably a girl. There you go again with the mind reading. This fella knows, you know, who's writing this, I'm saying. He also changes the subject when asked to prove his claims that I'm being paid. Because all I would do, whenever he alleged I was being paid, he'd say, go on, then prove it. Go for it, you know. The money's in a Nazi gold from a Bavarian lake and it's been sent through, you know. But you are a girl, though, he replies, aren't you? I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I very much adore our lady folk. Smiley emoji. However, doesn't it highlight what an absolute coward Mr. Murray is when faced with perfectly honest questions? For the record, whoever you are, I have no problems with you, love, no offence. Kiss. Now, this is happening at 0049 on the 23rd of February. So I'm up late, bored, can't sleep. Think, all right, let's have a little, we'll do some mud wrestling. Right? So when we, so, this is, oh, whoops. This is magnificent. This is magnificent. It's not. It's also not you offering any proof of the money or connections you've repeated allegedly, which is a shame because he was just so sure before. Have a peaceful evening. Give my love to Alistair and think of the future. Change is coming. Isn't it wonderful? Smiley face, vote UKIP, kiss. Again without that. I go, again without the proof and with the daft assertions. And then he'd gone on about the Metro ad. There was this thing that we had the front page of Metro ad and the rate card price for that was more than we were allowed to spend across the whole campaign,
right?
Across the long campaign. But of course we haggled, right? You don't, and it's illegal to overspend. So what you don't do as your opening thing is overspend so you'll go to prison. Generally, yeah. I reckon, if you're planning a thing. Anyway, but and they got very hung up on this idea that we'd overspend, right? And please learn to haggle. I'd hate to think you pay rate card for everything. It'd mean you're some kind of mug with no grip on how the real world works, right? And then he replies, well, maybe I'm right, and you're the lying, disgusting traitor to our people that I led you to be. We will never know until you answer my questions, will we? In the meantime, vote UKIP. Right? I don't have to answer your questions. You have to prove the assertions you're making, and please learn to haggle, or even learn that others might well haggle when on a limited budget. And the traitor thing, still a little bit fascist-y, especially when you keep repeating it. Right? And this guy, he was on my Facebook page every day for 4 months or something with this... with this tenor. I mean, it's beautiful. I don't know. And then he... This is... Can I read you this really long one, this bit?
Yeah, no, do. Really, we've got all the time in the world.
It's really good. I don't know, Al, as you change writer quite a lot. I don't. It's just been me all this time. Now, I've asked for a private message, I suspect, as I was speaking to your wife or your daughter, maybe. I don't even know if you have a wife or daughter, as I have absolutely no interest in your personal life, sir. However, there is no doubt at all in my mind that you are lying to our people, especially those in Thanet South. Do you know, Al, at first I was pretty angry because I felt betrayed by you, my last remaining funny comedian, as I said before. No way, not Al Murray, tell me I'm wrong. That was the thinking. Then I resolved myself to try to help expose you, as you know, to the best of my ability. Know that now, though, all that has kind of faded away as I become more and more at ease with how ridiculous this charade is, how quickly our people realised, and hopefully what then becomes votes for UKIP on May 7th. Quietly confident here, are you, right? 7 minutes later, what's your name out of curiosity? Because he thinks he's talking to this woman. I reply, whatever his name is, as if anyone's wife or daughter would be up at 0040 to talk to a stranger who persists in making bizarre claims about me. You're going to have to come up with some actual facts, some evidence, some proof if you're going to expose me to the best of your ability. You know, prove who's paid me, prove how they've contacted me, what they've asked me to do. Facts and that, rather than simply saying the same stuff over and over again in the hope it becomes true. You asked for private messages, having called me a traitor, treasonous, a liar and a fraud. It's not a great way to initiate a dialogue. Life lesson? And that was what I was dealing with.
Yeah.
On a daily basis. And it was really, I mean, you know, eye-opening. He's got the vote.
It's kind of rare on the internet that someone...
Oh, and then he posted a tribute to the Wehrmacht as a reply to me.
Usually on the internet, someone thinks they're talking to a young woman, it's a middle-aged, bald man. You've got UCLR.
He's trying to groom me.
He is. There's a definite element in that. It's like, I mean, it's the middle of the night and I'm talking to a woman. Yeah. So what's your name, love? What are you wearing?
It is fantastic. That video about the Wehrmacht says, strictly unpolitical video. Do not post any abusive, insulting, ultra-naturalistic, silly, religious, communistic or neo-Nazi comments, please. All right.
But other people argue the BBC paid for your campaign.
Yeah,
so that's why.
Yeah, yeah, because that's the other, you know, that's one of the...
Maybe it's the Tories and the BBC, they got together.
But also I'm a Labour stooge, because I'm a comedian, I'm Labour, right? you know, Lefty Labour, but or Lib Lab Con, which is the other one, New Libor. There used to be that really great insult about New Labour. There was ZANU Libor, like ZANU, you know, Zimbabwean, yeah. Libor. Brilliant. Amazing pun work there that brought Tony Blair's government down. And, the BBC funded it, because we did a programme for Dave, which came about because I was running, right? I mean, there's the other thing is people put a lot of carts in before horses and stuff. You know, they came to us and said, well, maybe there's a funny film in this. Do you want to make a thing? And we did it as if it was a fly on the wall documentary. And we used, the director of it was a woman called Amanda Blue, who's absolutely brilliant, and did one of these things with John Prescott, where she followed him around for 6 weeks, and filmed his every move and got to know him and all this sort of thing. And so we did that. And the first 2 days of filming, she decided she didn't want to meet me as me. She wanted to do the whole thing with me in character. And that she's going to treat me as though I was the real thing. And about halfway through the second day, she goes, can we just stop doing this? Because I was being such a dick, right? Between takes, you know, going, am I in the right place? Like, oh, you want me over there, do you? Oh, right, okay. Like being, and completely, oh, right, yeah, you're going to point that camera in my face. Like, being like the pub Lennon would be, like a complete bell end. And so we had to stop because you had to direct me. But the rub is, Dave is half-owned by BBC Worldwide.
Okay.
Which is the enterprise wing of the BBC, as people know. So it doesn't take the licence fee. His job is to sell programmes on. Half-owned by Worldwide. Because I think it used to be Gold. UK TV used to be Gold.
Yeah.
There's this weird lineage and, you know, all that. And that proves to people that my campaign was funded by the BBC. And they go, well, come on. And I go, no, it wasn't. And I had a day. I did a day of it, of replying to everyone, no, it wasn't. The way you rather did with International Men's Day.
Yeah.
Right? In many ways, you're directly responsible for my behaviour that day. And you get people going, well, come on, indirectly, going, no, I don't need to qualify the no. It wasn't funded by the BBC. It wasn't. And, you know, this relentless idea. I mean, I'm a bit insulted, really. I mean, a lot of them are going, oh, your career's over, that's why you've done it. So I'd send them the link to the gig at the Albert Hall next year, right? You know, because sometimes you've got to be a dickhead back. You've got to reply in kind. And you know, this funded by the BBC thing just kept coming up again and again and again and again. And, I was a little bit insulted that they thought I wasn't able to afford to run.
£500. Plus
well, no,
office.
And the advertising is a bit, it was a bit more than
that.
But
don't they give you a certain amount of
you get one. You get a mail shot, so you get to put a leaflet through everyone's door, which is a hilarious notion. You know, whoever runs, you get a leaflet. And so ours, you know, we put our free dog pledge in and 10 extra pennies in the pound. You see, that sounds reasonable, doesn't it? A pound is now £1.10. How's that different to anything else that's been offered in the last 5 months? Something about nurses, people love nurses. That was...
I think Malcolm Hardy once stood for local government so that he could get the mail shot, and then just did a mail shot of all of his club dates.
That's right, yeah.
So he worked out it's cheaper to do it by Britain.
Yeah, he's right. I mean, in a way, as a way of, I mean, what I've quite liked about it, it has delivered the haircut to the people who supposedly never knew the joke, never got the joke, because they are now really fucking angry with it. And that's fine.
Yeah.
All those people are, you know, and I have people go, your shows will be empty now. And I'd tweet them a picture of the show I'd just done with, you know, a couple of thousand people. You have to go, it wasn't empty tonight. It's been very revealing. And what I love about Twitter is because there is this kind of free speech on Twitter. What people forget about free speech is because you get to say whatever you like, dicks get to prove that they're dicks day in, day out, and that's really important.
And so did you see Farage beyond standing next to him on the hustings? Was it did you meet
no
him?
We I met him because what they do is they give you the result beforehand so that you can dispute it, so you can ask for a recount if you want, and you know, toyed with that idea. Well, there's a guy who ran for something calling himself the True United Socialist Party of Great Britain.
Right.
One of those kind of Judean People's Front type names.
Yeah.
And he got no votes, right? And he wanted to recount. He didn't. I don't think he got one, but he wanted to recount because he knew he'd voted for himself. And his wife and his dad had said they were going to vote for him as well. So he was three short. Fucking fantastic. Anyway, so...
They could have missed one, but his wife and his dad never voted for him. That's the terrible
never
thing.
Know, never know. But, you know, the secret ballot works if there's thousands of you, but not when there's three of you. But no, so we meet, you meet in the... And what is what I loved about it, you know, because in the Scots referendum, there were always people saying it was fixed and rigged and all this sort of stuff. And then people saying that Fannett was rigged, you know, it was this Fannett rigged hashtag. Having been on the floor in the count at the Winter Gardens at Margate, and it's all volunteers, and it's ladies with their bags of Maltesers, and it's all this sort of kids and people who, you know, doing it because they believe in it and all that. It happened in the Indy Ref in Scotland, and it happened again. It surfaced again here. You know, take a pen into the polling booth with you, because otherwise they're going to rub it out and put it in another box. You think, really? Let's just run through the practicalities of that, you know. And seeing those people count, and then hearing that crap, you just it makes you want to. It's like the moon landing. It's like people go, "Oh, didn't go." You know, yeah, they did actually. They really did go to the fucking moon. Shut up, right? And so it makes me feel like that about it. So you're in the count, and it's kind of like this. There was a stage here, and the returning officer says, "Right, I have the result of the general election in Thanet South constituency." And we all get all the candidates together. So there's me, the Tory guy, and the Tories. Tories knew they'd won. By the time we got there, about midnight, the exit polls were working out, and they knew they'd won.
Yeah.
Labour knew they'd lost and were despondent because I think that they felt a bit abandoned by central office. So the Tories are cock-hoop, Labour really despondent, but the UKIP table, because they knew they'd lost, at that table was like a scene from Downfall. It was amazing. They're all their heads on the table. Because also they all knew he was going to resign because he'd promised to resign if he lost.
Yeah.
So it was, you know, it was end of days that night because Nigel was going to fix it. No, he's not. You know, and he's got to quit because he's promised, and Nigel keeps his promises and all that sort of stuff. It's just politics. He's just a politician. That's what I think is really interesting about it. He's revealed himself as just being a politician now rather than sort of anything different. But and so we're then all stood in a gaggle, and I can't remember what he said to me. But I said something, he goes, "Have you won then?" Right? You know, and I said, "Well, it depends what you mean by win, Nigel." Because, right? You know, a vote for me is a vote denied and all that sort of stuff. And then, and we're hanging around and it's announced and it's all a bit, it's eggy to be honest, because no one can quite celebrate and no one can quite get upset because you then have to go out and do it again in front of the press. And there'd been 78 media requests that night for Margate, so it was really busy. People from all over the world, you know, all there to see this thing. And I think Farage had disappeared. He hadn't come in, certainly. No one knew who he was. And sort of disappeared a bit. A bit like on the night of the Indy Ref, Salmon got in his plane and flew around in circles before he figured out where he was going to go. It's kind of like that. And then you do your speeches. So basically, you go on the stage and they announce it. And no one else knows, but you know. So I'm thinking, well, I've managed to get stood between the guy who's won and the guy who's lost. Right? Because the other thing is, none of these politicians kind of have any showbiz instinct for walking on stage in lights, you know, and they don't know that you go downstage a little bit, act confident, you know, hi everybody, you know, shit eating grin, or like, huckstering that I'm really into anyway.
Yeah.
It's kind of my thing. And so I ended up stood between them and acted surprised when the result came out. Which proves, according to one conspiracist, that it was rigged, because how did I know the result before it was announced? Because you can see me going to smile. And also, I'm obviously in with the Tories because I shook the guy who won's hand, which is what I thought you did. You know, you shake the guy who won's hand, well done, mate, congratulations. Well done, bravo. Bad luck to the others, you know, like people do. But that's proof of something as well.
And also, if you were, it's a conspiracy, you might think I won't shake his hand, so it will look like we're not together.
Exactly. Whatever I'd have done.
Just for a second, I forgot. Yes, we did it.
We did it. Yes. Yeah. Use your bank account, please, Craig. Yeah. That nasty gold you promised me. And then what happened is Craig McKinley made his speech, who'd won. He made his speech, and then Nigel Farage made his speech, and he left. Went off. And everyone was very upset about that because you're supposed to stick around and you know go listen to the bloke who wants to bring about a unitary council in Kent. You know, actually he sounded like the bloke who really knew what he was talking about. But you know, you've got to listen to him even though he got 14 votes. You know, or whoever. You know, or Nigel from Bez's party. You've got to listen to them. You've got to listen to what they have to say because that's all part of the process. And you know, poor old, for whatever reason, Mr. Farage exited the stage, but there you go, you know, it's up to him.
And he's resigned, but he's unresigned.
Yeah.
So he's kept his promise.
Well,
he didn't say I wouldn't unresign.
Yeah, well. Exactly. And then I'm the only party leader who hasn't resigned. apart from David Cameron. We're the only two men standing. The Free United Kingdom Party marches on.
Did anyone from your party call for you to resign?
No.
Wow, that's pretty good. That's pretty impressed.
One of them's left. One of them has left. So there's two of us now.
Okay.
And we've wound it down actually because if you start doing it properly, because we had to have a party to run, and we had to have it approved by the Electoral Commission and our logo approved, and they were going, "You've stolen," you know, the angry kippers go, "You've stolen a pound off UKIP." Oh, I think the pound. Possibly predates. I don't know about that. And, you know, the Parlophone label's a pound sign, although it's a, you know, it's a German L and all that. And but the one thing that people did keep saying is you're going to confuse people with your party name on the voting slip. And our party's called the Free the United Kingdom Party, right? You know, it's a fuck up, isn't it? It's funny, isn't it? Right. Well, it's not very funny.
Everyone's just got it.
Yeah, you've just got it. Serviceable, well, you can't tell people what to think, can you? Serviceable, you know, for what we were doing. And people are going, people are going to look at that electoral slip and see FUKP and think it's UKIP, right? Now, first of all, their absolute headline guy is running their constituencies. If they're getting that wrong, right, they're not really paying attention. And also, they are very, very different. Look, and we weren't allowed to use an acronym. So it wouldn't even look like it. It wasn't the same, and we're different candidates. Although there is the thing with the literal Democrats who lost the Liberals a load of votes a couple of years ago.
Right.
3 or 4 years ago, it's quite interesting.
Yeah.
They're on the form as literal Democrats. A lot of people go like that, because they didn't know who the candidates were.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's been really interesting seeing all these loonies crawl out of the woodwork.
Yeah. Has it been worth it?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Because it was an amazing experience to be at that, to be there on that stage next to it, and to be kind of caught up in it and understand a bit more, like kind of also how people view politics. You know, suddenly an election looms. The people who are interested are really interested.
Yeah.
And the people who kind of aren't. And I don't know where you get them to be. You probably don't. You know. And that was interesting in itself. You know, we had enough lads. I go walk about in Margate or Ramsgate. Have enough lads go, "What are you doing here, Al?" And I go, "Well, I'm running for Parliament." "What are we on about?" And so they didn't know I was running, which isn't, I'm not worried about that. And, you know, the election next month. What election? And they wouldn't, you know, and you think, fuck me, how do you not know?
Yeah.
And that's, I don't know what you do about that.
Make compulsory voting?
Yeah, but, yeah, maybe. I don't know. How do you enforce that? That's your problem. With such a big electorate.
Death sentence.
Yeah. Do you want to join them? We were going to bring back hanging for the sake of the rope industry.
They've got it in Australia, compulsory voting, haven't they?
But yeah, there's a much smaller population, isn't it?
Yeah.
And always was, and so it's been permanent as part of their culture. Foisting it on might be quite difficult.
I just feel like if you do make it compulsory, that people would deliberately just go in and vote for nasty.
Well, you want none of the above, don't you? You need none of the above box if you've got compulsory, I suppose. But I don't know. I mean, we approach this much more from the angle of look at this, look at how these politicians are talking to us, look at what they're offering, how is it working, what the hell is going on, rather than kind of, I'm going to do the Russell Brand thing. Like, I'm not offering any solutions, it's just a comedian. I can't help you. Yeah, sorry, Governor. Which is the thing he does when someone like Brian May says to him, "Well, what do we do then?"
It's a good question. I have to ask you this. This is from Barry Price. He's paid £60 to ask you this question.
Awesome. So, is he here?
Are you in, Barry? Don't care that much about it. And he's paid £60 for this, so here we go. Baked beans on a fry-up, yes or no?
What does on mean?
Well, I can only...
I have baked beans with a fry, but not on. To the left of the egg. Nothing right. Must be on the egg.
Okay.
I eat the egg last.
Yeah.
Eat the yolk last. And once a year I have a piece of fried bread. Because if I had... it's that I eat every day. Because yeah. Fried bread is the most delicious food stuff on the planet. So I have one bit of fried bread a year. I treat myself to a fried slice. And yeah, egg to one side, beans. Never the grilled tomato. The grilled tomato is not welcome on my breakfast plate.
I don't like tomato or beans. I think I don't like the beans on there.
Yeah, beans are good.
I have porridge. Don't want baked beans on that.
You know, the only... Right. Well, I was going to say something about when I was told to eat porridge, but that was... I was told I had to because of, you know...
Public school?
No.
Okay, so I'm misunderstanding.
Piles?
Oh, really?
Yeah. So you saying I eat porridge, I'm thinking of one thing, Richard.
Yeah, no piles. Although I admitted
not
recently, I really like porridge. I'd have my make it every day for my wife, and before that, even before my wife, I made it for every day for whoever was in my bed. That was one of the. I'm very very good at it, making porridge. But it's got like berries from Marks and Spencer's and stuff in it.
Oh, do you put berries in
Matilda?
It?
Matilda.
Do you put berries in it?
Yeah, berries, nuts and seeds.
You are the London metropolitan liberal elite.
No salt. I don't put salt in it. I don't put any. Oh. I don't put any sugar.
You hate Scotland.
I'm refusing to go there this year. That's all that's happening.
Are you not going?
I'm not doing Edinburgh.
Have you not been to Edinburgh this year?
that's right. Yeah. My wife did the book festival. And I can't remember if we finally agreed that I would stay at home and look after the baby or if we'd all go. Oh, I can't remember what we did now. Now I think back to it. Either I went up for a night or I didn't go.
Well, I was on in a venue that it doesn't matter now.
Because you did all your shows, your old shows.
Yeah.
Which I'm doing all my... Well, I've done all my old shows.
Yeah,
it was great.
I did four on consecutive days.
Yeah.
How I relearned them.
Did you find that? How long? Because I haven't really started massively learning quite a few of them yet. Did you do it quick? Was it? Did they come back quickly?
The second one, I knew. Apart from a couple of things,
yeah.
I just knew it. Because I did it a lot.
Yeah.
And then the third one, I could do it now. I mean, start to finish, you just know that, and it's super hardwired also for how a lot of the stuff I've written since. You know, the kind of not templates is the wrong word, but the way of doing it. The fourth one is the one I can remember, the one I know now. But the first one, not really, not so much. And that was agony remembering that, because
yeah.
That's when I was more doing clubs and before I got into doing hour long shows with the character.
Yeah.
Second one was the one where I had a real breakthrough on the writing, and so I like that show. I'm really proud of it, so it's easy to remember. The third one, I have these lists and I save everything. And the list for the third show, which was called. I can't remember what it's called.
It's not a good start.
I'd look at the list and it would say rabbits or something like that. You know, in 1998, that meant everything. I knew exactly what that meant. No idea.
Right.
And I hadn't recorded any of it. So that was actually one was really difficult to reassemble.
Yeah.
And then while I was reassembling it, I realised I basically got a couple of things actually the wrong way around, and they'd work better if I'd done them the new way around. So I changed it.
Yeah.
Because you might as well. Because you would have done that. I would have done that anyway.
Yeah.
But I did them four consecutive afternoons, and they went really, really well. And the thing I didn't used to do when I first started out was so much of the audience interaction stuff. I wasn't really into that. I'd have one person that I would use for a thing, but I'd never did the, working the front couple of rows. And so the shows were, it was an hour of material, so it was actually quite a lot to remember.
Yeah.
But it went really well. I can recommend it. And your brain does this thing where it suddenly a bit... goes, it's like opening a door. I mean, not Darren Brown Mind Palace. You know, I live in a castle, I keep an ace of clubs in a chest. The ace of clubs means Jeff. Jeff means knight takes king's pawn. You know? Just remember knight takes king's pawn. You know? It's not like that, but you'd suddenly go, oh God, yeah, of course, that leads to that. Yeah,
yeah.
And out it comes. But I know those shows, those four shows really well. I know this year's show really well, and the one from the year before last. But I basically got like a 10-year gap where I can't really remember any of it. Because I wrote five shows very fast on the trot, and you know, and it's that pressure. And if I had to do what you were doing, it would be really hard going.
Yeah.
But I've got about 24 hours of material now.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I'm getting up to that sort of level. So, yeah, it is.
I expect you'll go back and you'll have repeated yourself really not very much.
Yeah, no, I haven't really.
Which is the thing. People who write a lot don't. It's the people who don't write very much who kind of get stuck. Because I would get told, oh, it's the same old character. And actually, I look at my set list and it may be the same old character in the same way that it's the same old Richard Herring or the same old whoever.
Yeah.
But the shows are radically different every time. We're radically different approaches to stuff. And there was one year where, you know, I was just thinking, I'm absolutely fed up being told it. I just bang on about the French. And there was no mention at all of France or the French, right? And a review went, oh, there he is again, banging on about the French again. I never fucking said it. But then again, I think comedy is quite weirdly served critically. So I don't even want to touch on. Because we'll be here for another hour and a half.
It is, that's true.
Really bugs me.
I think there's definitely a case where there's a review. Some of the review is written before the show.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Well, then there's been some reviews where I want to say, what did I talk about? Yeah. What about the 10 minutes about moral relativism? Because there was last show, there's 10 minutes about moral relativism. From the pub landlord's point of view, so it's completely mental. talking about it.
I'll ask you an emergency question.
Yep.
Just because, we haven't done one. Except we did the ghost one backstage. He hasn't seen the ghost. Oh, spoiler alert.
They don't exist.
but have you ever seen a Bigfoot?
I've seen that photo of a bloke in a Bigfoot suit. Yeah. Everyone says it's proof of a Bigfoot.
Yeah. Did you ever see this?
Like this, isn't it?
Yeah. And looking around. Could be.
Did you get that? Steve, did you get the picture? It's hot in this goddamn suit.
I will ask.
Are your feet big enough? Feet aren't big enough.
Do you think of terrorist atrocity ideas that would be good to carry out if you were a terrorist? Because I do this all the time. I'm constantly. Do you ever think of any good ones? I'm very obsessed with it. I'm obsessed with planning my escape routes from places.
We could get quite serious about this, couldn't we, actually?
I think you'd be...
I don't know if I actually don't know if I can talk about this. I don't know if I can.
Okay, don't.
But shopping centres make me very nervous.
Yeah, me too.
And last time I took my kids to Westfield, because my kids go to Westfield all the time, and last time I went to Westfield, I just got into this... What if the thing in Kenya happens?
Yeah.
Because I'm amazed it hasn't happened yet. I'm just amazed. And the thing they rehearsed the other day at the tube station. Yeah. It's just, and apparently it's harder to buy automatic weapons here and all that sort of stuff. So. And I'm just thinking, when's that going to happen? So the last time I went with my kids, I figured out how I'd get out of that situation. What would I do? Where do we go? How do we deal with it? And then I said to my, said to my girlfriend when I got home, it's all I could think about. It's all I could think about when we were there. And, my eldest is just about turned 16, my youngest is 12. They're very confident London kids, and certainly know their way around Westfield Shopping Centre. But then the thought of, the thought of gunfire one end of the shopping centre and it all kicking off. I'm not planning anything. I'm planning how to get away should it occur.
Can run upstairs in Starbucks... And then upstairs, and then if they come up there, you can be hiding behind a door, and you can swing the door around in their face.
Most of those shops, though, have a. Most of those shops, you get into their backstage, and surely down and out and all that. But it's really, we're taking quite a turn here, aren't we?
Yes.
I haven't planned any mentally. No.
If it has happened by September, we didn't know. We didn't know. If I've been caught up in the middle... I live near there,
Yeah, I know.
It's very... It makes it a very saleable house I live in. You would think. All right, I'll ask you a less nasty one.
Well, it's not nasty. I mean, it's like a bit serious, isn't it, Rich?
Yeah.
It's serious.
It is serious.
You're like deep.
But it's also fun to think up how you would
do
one.
No, it's not.
Just on a practical level, it's like how you would, take out like the Nazis in a war simulation.
All right,
simulation.
That's different. If we're talking about that, then I'm right up there.
If you were trying to rescue Mussolini from a clifftop hotel,
gliders.
Yeah, that's correct. That is the way to do it.
I'd get Otto Scorsese in to do it.
That would even be the ideal
Nazi
man.
Nazi Falchiamiego super soldier, yeah.
The ideal man to do
it. Dueling scars on his face from when he was at Heidelberg University, but they'd fight with swords. He was a horrible man. Ended up living in Ireland and was a friend of the Taoiseach at one point.
That was
Got let off war crimes.
Because he was very excited. That was a very exciting way to rescue Mussolini.
It's amazing. It's brilliant. Yeah. It's really, really smart. Yeah.
That's all true. That's how they rescued Mussolini. Yeah. Then he got strung up from a lamppost. So, you know, in a way, maybe should have stayed in that hotel for a bit. You can stay in the hotel. Did you write about this in your book?
Yeah, I did.
And
Scorsese was involved in the war crimes in the Ardennes offensive, the Battle of the Bulge, where the Germans all dressed up as Americans and drove around on jeeps and stuff, and ridiculously had lessons to learn the rules of baseball and all that sort of thing, just in case, you know. Hey pal, do you know the rules of baseball? Yeah, das Hitter ist auf das Zimmer.
Yeah, it's kind of a thing you would never ask someone who you assumed was from the same place as you.
So, but Scorsese was tried after the war. I think this is right. Scorsese was tried after the war, and this secret agent, his name I can never remember, but his code name was the White Rabbit.
Right.
Who was an SOE guy. I remember his name in a minute, it'll come to me. He came forward and said, well, I dressed up in enemy uniform, so you've got to let him off. It's not that bad, I did it. And stood on the stand for him. And he, as a result, he wasn't hanged, which is kind of weird, really. Because Joachim Peiper, who was there was another war criminal in the Battle of the Bulge, who ran into a similar situation.
Yeah.
It's all quite odd, all that, after the war, all those soldiers come on, everyone did it.
They all sort of respected it. I mean, Churchill
when you look
Churchill
at who they respected.
Churchill said it was good what they did with those, but he said that was a very bold, way he said. Which it was.
Yeah, it was amazing. It is amazing. It's proper where eagles dare stuff, but as the Germans do, it's a bit embarrassing.
It's very
Roger Burton shit-faced.
It's a very good book, the Watching War Films.
Oh, thank you.
That's what it's called. It's sort of a biography,
but
it's a bit about your dad, and it's a bit about being a dad. It's well worth reading.
Thank you.
I'm not saying the other ones aren't, but that one's very good. I haven't read the latest one.
Well, Let's Read Great Britain, the Pub Landlord's Manifesto to Fixing Broken Britain.
That sounds good too, but does it have stuff like people flying in?
No, it's not going to be gliders in it.
No, well, I like that. That's why
jokes
in it. I like Colditz and stuff. If you were in Colditz, how would you escape?
Well, there's that guy who got out, wasn't there? He made a fake uniform and walked straight out of the prison saluting everybody.
Yeah. That's quite a good way to do it.
It's fucking amazing.
Do you think you could do that?
I don't know that I could do that.
I don't think I could do it. It's amazing the things they did. They built a glider in Colditz.
Built a glider. Yeah, while doing a play, didn't they? They did a play and they... I mean, there's that thing where they would scavenge wood from the building and build stuff. Yeah. They're really amazing.
They built a glider in the attic. The Germans never check the attic. That's what you have to learn. If the Nazis ever come back, get in the attic. They do after a little while. Don't stay up there more than 3 or 4 years.
That's what they're looking for.
I think I did that joke last week. Okay. It gets very difficult to keep up with. I'll end in a sec. How are you on... I bet you stack the dishwasher in your house. I bet you do.
What?
I bet that's your job. You stack the dishwasher.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Which way up do you put the cutlery in the dishwasher?
Knives down.
And what about forks?
Forks up.
Everything down.
No way.
Yeah.
You do spoons down?
Yeah.
Yeah, I completely
idiot. Everything down. How are you going to get it out?
I mean, I've tolerated some of your more harebrained political schemes to save this country.
How are you going to get the spoons out? By holding on to the spoon? Got to put the handle so you can pick the handles out.
Your hands before you empty the dishwasher.
Still, it's still that. Look at that. However clean your hands are, there's still sweat on them.
Your own sweat.
Yeah, but you might be serving.
Have you got Ebola? You're going to give yourself Ebola
by
emptying the dishwasher. You haven't thought it through.
You've got to put everything down. My wife sat the dishwasher the other day, and there was a peach stone between two plates. That's how bad she is at stacking. I got out and put it. I put the plates were quite close together. Might have been a nectarine. I eat exotic fruit. Get over it. And she put them in, and then I was putting them back in the thing, and I thought, that hasn't gone down very well. Lifted up the plate, there was a peach, a nectarine stone.
Richard, you need to calm down. I don't think that peach stone is worth half of everything.
She's just like, that's my area. I do the bin. I make the porridge. She was never interfered with that. We've accepted these ground rules. The dishwasher, I do that.
Your
I put the bins out.
Your wife is a wonderful woman.
I put the bins out. She can do all the other stuff.
Okay.
I wash up the bottles for the baby. That's my job.
Really?
And put them in the steriliser. I like that.
Dear.
It's satisfying. My baby started eating food now. It's annoying.
You've changed.
I want my baby to stay being a baby forever. Do you think that's wrong? Everyone says they get more interesting, but I really like her being
a
baby.
They're much more interesting.
I like her being a baby. I don't want to. I can't
How
imagine.
How old is she now?
It depends when you mean by now. She was 5 months old at the end of July. That's an odd thing to say.
So she's 7 months old now?
Yeah, I guess.
Lovely.
Time passes so fast.
Was she sleeping through in July?
Yes. She really? Slept through nearly.
Teething?
She's just coming through.
Oh.
It's really good. She's very
you
happy.
You wait till she's 15.
I know.
Fuck me.
I'll be dead by then. I've got everything planned out. It's all carefully planned out.
You're going to choke on a peach stone in the.
I nearly did. I nearly choked on an apricot stone. That's what I talked about the other week. That was a callback for people.
Oh, right.
Yeah. But not these people, because that one hasn't gone out yet either.
God help us.
The people at home are loving the fruit
all
stone.
The stuff
basically.
That could happen in the next 2 months.
Yeah.
You know.
You have to not worry about it, because people will be listening to this probably in the year 3000.
Yeah.
So, you know, the topical stuff, they'll go.
This doesn't end up in the National Library of Congress. Something's gone very wrong.
My blogs are in the British Library, so, you know, no
well,
one
you
will
left
ever
them
read
there.
Them. Yes. Just
on
the toilet.
Left a USB stick on the desk. On reception. Here you go. You've been eating this.
They emailed me and asked me if they could have them in the library. I said, yeah. They're on the internet for free, you pricks. I've never known, right. So I reckon, what do you reckon the last date that someone will listen to this podcast will be? Someone will probably listen to it in like 50 years time, one person. You are that person. Hello, what's it like? Sorry about all the global warming. Sorry you're underwater. We're not sorry, we're glad, we didn't care. We've got loads of lights on here, you wouldn't believe it. Nice, I like that idea.
Well, yeah, there'll be some poor benighted PhD student trying to unravel British comedy.
This will be a brilliant resource if they take out all the cocksucking, all that stuff. They take out most of the
but
stuff
are you,
in it.
All right, so let's go the full distance for this. Are you prepared in the event of a cataclysm?
Yeah.
This is a question I often ask myself, actually, for this to be the remaining artifact of Western of human civilization.
Yeah,
whoever comes and finds Earth,
yeah,
or the apes, or whoever gets it, finds your podcast.
It would be confusing, wouldn't it? But then you don't know, do you?
Yes.
The things that survive, you don't know, do you? How many amazing plays from ancient Greece have disappeared completely? Most of them. There's a few that survive. I mean, a lot of the good things will survive because there's been lots of copies of them, especially now.
Yeah, but isn't there a concern with technology that, because we've gone totally, you know, lots of people have gone paperless and the hard drives are all dying and it's all going to get lost.
Yeah.
And the historians aren't going to have all the emails and all that.
Yeah.
Is there a worry?
I think it's probably.
I think
you
need to find some kind of cryogenic way of saving this podcast for humanity, yeah. Richard.
I'll put it in a plant of some kind. I'll find a way to put it in a redwood tree. You can just plug in some earplugs. It's constantly playing in there.
But then in 1,000 years' time, it could be like where people come to learn wisdom.
Yeah.
You'd be like some sort of god.
I think that's what I'm hoping. I want to be famous in 500 years' time when it's no fucking use to anyone. That's when I was at the Van Gogh Museum, and that's kind of the worst, isn't it? The worst thing that possibly happened is you're
never sold a painting, yeah.
Yeah, if you're a genius and you die, kill yourself. He shot himself in a field and then walked back into town and then died. It's awful. Poor bloke. He'd already cut off his ear. Mm. He shot himself, walked back into town, doesn't know anyone, thinks he's any good, and then And then and he did a painting a day pretty much for the last year of his life. So every day he was basically printing £30 million for somebody else to have.
Yeah.
Be annoying.
It's no way to go, is it?
Do you think if that was you and you could then look back at it, you go, oh, well, at least they recognised him in the end, or fuck, that's an awful...
I think, fuck, that's awful.
Yeah.
You know, they did a Doctor Who about it, though, didn't they?
They did, yeah.
Yeah, we went back and had a look.
And then they told him he was good.
Yeah, he told him he was a genius. Killed himself anyway.
Did.
Yeah. Well done, Doctor.
Could have put him in the TARDIS
exactly,
to take him to the future.
In the TARDIS. Don't worry about it, mate.
Come to the Van Gogh Museum, have a look around.
Well, they did that.
Yeah. Oh, they did do that.
They did that. Yeah. They showed him and then he killed himself anyway. I mean, what use is it being a Time Lord if you can't save Vincent Van Gogh?
It's a good question. That is going to be the title of this podcast, if I remember.
And in the year 3535.
Yeah. Oh, well, been quite good fun, hasn't it?
Yeah.
I quite
nice,
like it.
Nice people you get.
They are nice. They're a very nice audience, aren't they? They'll put up with anything.
I can't tell what they're laughing at, though. I don't know what they're really laughing at.
No, it's very difficult to know.
Some of them, I think, identify with you.
I think, yeah.
I think that everything you say is true.
Yeah. I think they're all racist. And yeah. They're laughing at me because they think I'm slightly Chinese.
Yeah.
That is what I think they're all thinking. And you can't prove me wrong, because if you ask them, they're not going to admit that, are they?
Yeah, exactly.
Are you laughing at him because you think Chinese people are inherently funny? Look at them laughing, they're laughing more now. Just proves my point.
Yeah, you're proving your point quite beautifully.
Thank you.
It's good to see you, Richard.
It's nice to see you, it's been a little while. Is Time Gentleman Please ever coming back?
I don't know, you'd have to ask Richard Herring.
No,
on Twitter it's bring back. That's the thing I really love, is people's faith hashtags, but also our faith in our power in controlling our controlling our destiny.
Yeah.
They go, for God's sake, bring back Time Gentleman Please, Al. They go, well, I can't. No one wants it. They didn't want it at the time. You know, and I find that really endearing, you know. We've been making it, but it's me withholding it.
Yeah.
And it's the same with my old chat show, Happy Hour. When are you going to bring back Happy Hour, Al? Well, I can't. They cancelled it. You know, I'd love to, you know, but it's an odd one, that. And I think it's quite sweet that people...
We might still be making episodes of Time Gentleman Please and just not putting them out. That might be what we're doing. Got all the cast together.
What, apart from me?
I think you were holding the rest of us back.
Probably.
I think the postman in that really deserved a spin-off. That's what everyone thinks.
He was great.
He needed a sort of spin-off.
Young, really young guy. That's what was good about him. He was really young.
He
was really, really young.
He was. It was a long time ago.
Strangely Chinese, though.
He was a bit Chinese.
I think that's why he was getting laughs. You know, there's someone going to Edinburgh who's going to do a show all in Mandarin, and based on the idea that all of 97% of communication or something is non-verbal.
Yeah, I didn't know that. I hear it was very good.
Oh yeah. You know, someone went to Edinburgh.
There's someone in Edinburgh in 2015 doing a show called Christ on a Bike, which I find quite offensive, just that they obviously don't know that I did a show called Christ on the Way, as it seems this audience don't know either. But that's kind of, you'd think...
You're being disrespected there.
You'd think someone would go,
you're being disrespected.
But then Chappie Chris Andy did a show called Moon on a Stick and didn't know that we...
You're being disrespected again.
And then someone did a thing about having a British moon on a British stick.
Yeah, that was
I don't know where that came from. Oh, that's right.
It was as well. Look, that'll get the five people who still give a shit. They'll like that.
We've done long enough. Well, we can do some more. What's the feeling in the room? I never ask you if you want to carry on or do you want to go home?
Carry on!
Who wants to go home? Well, that one bloke. You know what?
Rich, that was a real high wire at you just
It was. Anyone who wants to go home, you can just go home anytime you want. If you didn't know, the doors, they open. People come, what time does it end? Whenever you want it to. It's fine. I've got to get a train. What time does it end? Just leave 15 minutes before the train comes. We're doing more of these in... actually, they'll have started by the time this goes out.
You, I mean, thinking about it, we talked about Doctor Who a moment ago. You'd be a shit Time Lord.
I would. We've started doing some more of these.
You can't even deal with time in the order it's going.
We have 2 weeks for every week. That's the problem with it. I've managed to cram 2 weeks into a week. That should have been one of your policies.
I think we offered we did offer some change to the working week. I can't remember what it was. We're far ranging.
Yeah.
Far ranging stuff. You know. I'm trying to remember something. I've forgotten it all.
But anyway, in the autumn, as you know, people who are in the autumn, I mean, this is the autumn. We're going to be recording these on Sunday afternoons at 4 o'clock, which will be interesting to see how that works. It's because Stuart Lees takes over the theatre, because he won't play a theatre with enough seats in it for all the people who want to come and see him.
Right.
What he prefers to do is play a small theatre for 11 weeks.
What, make it look busy?
Yeah. So we'll be on Sundays at 4 o'clock. What do you think? Would you come and see us at 4 o'clock?
Why doesn't he play a porter cabin for 58 weeks?
It would be helpful.
Got to keep the hitting the ticket, Rich.
But it does mean the people who live outside of London, you could come down, make a weekend of it, go and see a show on Saturday, come down, then easily get a train home, back to wherever you live. Probably not Inverness. The night train.
Sunday at 4 o'clock, that's an interesting...
Yeah, we'll see if it works.
Yeah. It's an interesting, different
Because the thing, these people on a Monday evening, they're whipped up into a drunken state of euphoria. And racism.
Certainly.
And
certainly desperate to be entertained.
Don't listen to anything though. It's really, you know, sort of thing. When will the spell be broken? And they'll just say, it's just a man asking the same 5 questions over and over again for a long time. It's much too long. It's Stockhausen syndrome they've got. That's what they've got. My favourite joke I've ever done about Stockhausen.
It's a really funny joke.
But it never...
No, it goes for nothing.
No one ever likes it. Because Stockhausen's really rubbish unless you listen to it.
Yeah, no one really knows about Stockhausen.
Yeah. It's annoying. So anyway, you need to know quite a lot of things to make for that joke to work. That's the problem. People know one or the other or neither, I've discovered.
Can we do a straw poll? Who knows who Stockhausen is?
Not
hands,
many
hands. Right, that's nowhere near enough to do that joke.
No. Even in this very highly educated audience, though it's your audience have come this week, so they're a bit stupid.
Of course, they're thick.
They're just appreciating all this on one level.
Yeah.
On the level that
face
it seems
value.
To
People taking it at face value. How do you know? So bored of that one.
Who knows what Stockholm is? But who knows what Stockholm syndrome is? You've got it then, David. It's a shame that I know the name of the bloke.
So,
I can name the person.
Are you actually going to explain the joke?
So Stockhausen syndrome would be if you listen to Stockhausen and for long enough in a room locked into it, you would start to enjoy it. Yeah, David laughed. He laughed. David laughed, but he's the only person.
That's amazing.
He really laughed. He really went, even though he'd kind of done the joke nearly.
He's like patient zero.
It's a good joke, isn't it, Dave? Because Stockhausen's rubbish. It's all discordant and stuff, isn't it? But if you listen for long, I presume that's what happens. So there must be. They should have.
Well,
a
I wonder if he even liked it.
Probably not.
No, probably not. Can't. See if I can get away with this.
they're leaving. The two people have taken the. I'll get them on the film. They're in the dark. It was too much. Wasn't it? It was
people.
Too far, wasn't it? The stock.
It's too edgy.
Having to go to Stockhausen.
Just
too
edgy.
Much.
Some things are sacred.
Was it when you realised I wasn't Chinese? Was that what put you off? Have a good train home. Hope you got something out of the evening. That's nice. He's bent down for the camera. But that might. Are you two having an affair? And that's why you're leaving like these two. These two at least had the balls to sit in the front row to have their affair.
Have you ever actually had that an actual affair at the front of a show?
I don't know. Have you?
I have. Yeah.
Yeah. You've found them out.
Yeah.
And they've admitted it.
Yeah. It was amazing. You know, because I ask people stuff.
Yeah.
And I said, so is this your wife? He went... So someone else's wife, and she went. And there we are. Where do they? And you know, then you're into. Do they? Does your wife know where you are? You know, like, it's fucking amazing. It's really funny. Yeah.
You've got. They feel they have to tell you the truth.
It's very odd.
They're not going to be very good at having an affair if just someone. Are you having an affair? Just pretend that's what you have to do. You have to be good at lying. It's the lies that get you. That's why I think Gary Sparrow, I think that's why Goodnight Sweetheart never really explored the duplicity through time because he never really felt bad about what he
was doing.
But
they used to record that in July and put it out in September.
And it was a complicated thing, his journey through time. But I think he would feel, I think that would be interesting to find if he was really racked with guilt about what he was doing, which I think he would be. What do you think, Dave? If you were to travel through time in a wormhole, which you could probably create being a nuclear physicist, and you were having an affair with a barmaid in the war, and then also were married, I don't know if you are married, but you know, yeah, you are.
It'd be fine. You'd
be all right, you wouldn't feel guilty. Your wife might see this. The first rule of having sex through time with two women is you pretend that you wouldn't do that, because there's no way you could never get caught, Gary Sparrow. Mm. Except in that episode, of course, when the wife came through the wormhole and met Phoebe in the bar. I've got the whole thing on, I've got all of it on. There was a time when I watched them all, they were on ITV4. And what's that about? Because it's a BBC show, right? Come on. How did the BBC sell it to ITV? That's a sitcom in itself. So I watched them all, I got quite obsessed with it.
Really?
Yeah. I'm writing a sitcom about parallel universes.
Ah.
I've combined Sliding Doors and Goodnight Sweetheart to create a new thing.
Sliding Sweetheart?
Yeah. But I'm gonna fully explore problems.
Really?
Yeah.
Come off it.
Probably already be out by September. Given I've not written a word of it yet. And have to learn 12 shows. Anyway.
I think we've driven this into the ground.
We were doing well. We should have left when I said, before we asked them.
Leave them wanting.
Are you regretting saying you weren't what you wanted to see more? Or are you glad you wanted to see more? No. Do you want us to do some more? Yeah. We're not going to. We interestingly do one week. I just feel slightly guilty for the people who work in the theatre and would like to go home. George the Sandman there, who... He just laughed at that because he wants to go home. But the first rule of being a sound guy is not to be audible in the podcast. For him just go, bleh, and really laugh because he wants to go home.
Yeah, but you earlier on when Craig and George came in to film us.
In our secret bit to get backstage.
Exclusive backstage footage.
Good.
Really, really excited to get that extra little nugget, isn't it? And... They came in, Craig and George came in, and Rich went, this is Craig and George. And you know what he did? He immediately made the cameraman more important because he said his name first.
Yeah.
You see? You created hierarchy, you're oppressing George.
George created the hierarchy.
Jibe about George.
Yeah.
You know.
But then George is like becoming a character and is like a mysterious figure. Everyone knows he's packed there, but no one knows what he looks like. He's worried he'll lose work becoming a notoriously, you know, because he messes everything up. And he's worried that by me saying that will lose him work in the future. Because his full name comes up in the credits, if you want to check him out. But he's for the money, he's very good. You can't expect to get all the sounds from the amount we're paying.
You know, no one's going to hear any of this.
He has the power. He has the power. If he was any good, he could make that happen and stop it. But he isn't good enough. He's very good. If you need anyone to record some sound, any of you at home, probably at home. Is anyone looking for someone to record some sound? If you don't mind him laughing over what you're doing.
If you're going to have an affair in 1946, you probably need to record some sound of you still being in the house.
Yeah, that could work.
To play to your wife.
That could work.
I'm upstairs.
Yeah. But Craig's like really good. He works on Sunday brunch sometimes. Sunday lunch. What's it called? Was that someone in the morning?
Sunday brunch.
Sunday brunch.
Sunday in the morning.
And and he works on The Right Stuff sometimes.
Yeah.
Like proper TV shows.
That's Matthew Wright host, though.
Yeah, he's good.
It's brilliant the way those names work.
Yeah. Does Ian brunch do Sunday? anyway, we should. We'll probably cut all this bit out. Apart from the bit about George. George laughed. He laughed again. Can you pick up your own laughter on the mics, George, or not? No. No, but can you what? You just said something then,
though. Shut up, George. Not supposed to reply. He's falling for it every time. George, you're right.
He's learning.
He's learning, yeah.
He's actually just left. It's him walking out. He's just pulled out the tape, ripped it to pump, because that's how we do it now. We're going to go. It's been very nice to see you all. Thank you for coming along. We're doing another one next time, which is sold out, with Limmy and Joe Lycett. It's going to be lots of fun.
Oh, wow.
So that's the last two in this series, and then there'll be more. We might do another Kickstart for the next series, but it's probably finished by now, by the time you're hearing this. And if we don't donate, we won't really see it anyway. Didn't think it through. Okay, thank you very much. Give a big round of applause, Al Murray.
Richard Herring, the human man. He's why you're here.
How'd you like them sky potatoes?